everybody. Welcome to Inside the Album. I'm Don Seckler. That's Tommy Hilken. How's it going today, Tom?
Good morning, Don. It's going real well, man. Hanging, chilling, doing good.
Good. Awesome.
Oh, yeah.
So we're back with another classic rock and roll album here. And we're going to talk about Guns N' Roses' Appetite for Destruction. But before we get started, don't forget to subscribe, like, do all the things, click all the buttons, check out our website, insidethealbum.com. We actually have merch there if you're interested in some rock and roll t-shirts.
Nice.
Yeah. And so we also do some work with a charity. And so, Tom, tell us all about Music for Mark.
Well, Music for Mark, we want to get it rocking. We want to get it rolling. So if you could help us out, what we do is we want to bring musical instruments to kids who don't have them and don't have any chance of ever getting them to keep the music alive. So musicformark.com, check it out. All we want to do is get musical instruments in the hands of kids who really want to play but don't have a chance to get out there and get what they need. So that's what we want to do.
Awesome.
That's what we're looking to do. And in 2023, anybody wants to give us a buzz or an email, connect with us to help us out with this situation would be fantastic.
That'd be great.
Yep.
All right. So let's take a look at the band. The Appetite for Destruction is the first album from Guns N' Roses and came out in July of 1987. To us, it seems like just yesterday, us young lads. It's actually quite a bit of time.
Wow.
Yeah, I was actually still in college at this when this was released.
So I was still in jail.
Not really. So the band is made up of a lot of pretty well-known figures. Axl Rose, lead vocalist. I'm sure pretty much everybody is aware of Axl. Slash as well as the guitar player. And, you know, again, I'm sure a lot of people know Slash. The rest of the band members were Izzy Stradlin was the other guitar player. Duff McKagan on bass guitar and Steven Adler on drums.
Right.
So the album was recorded in over 6 months from January through June of 1987 and then released, like I said previously, in July of 1987. And at the time, the charts, we were kind of coming out of, you know, kind of coming out of the 80s, right? It's 1987 and starting to, you know, get out of the whole hair metal thing is still there, but, you know, it's not as lively as it was 3-4 years ago, like 1984, 85. That was where kind of the peak of that, I think.
Go ahead, say it. It was coming to the end of the hair bands.
The hair bands. Yeah, they were coming to an end. But dude,
the best hair bands says it all. Go ahead.
Tom's not a fan. No. So one of the hair bands, Def Leppard, was on the chart this year, 1987, with Hysteria, which was an enormous record for them.
Great album, actually.
Other great albums or other albums that were on the chart at this time, Joshua Tree by U2, which pretty much dominated this year. That was an extremely popular album and probably to this day, U2's biggest album. We also had Licensed Ill by the Beastie Boys, which was out there. That was a whole new thing with, you know, white rappers, which at the time was really unusual.
Licensed Ill was a great album.
It is a great album. Oh, we may actually do that one.
Yeah,
that even though it's fun. Not technically rock, but it's a rocking album.
Well, it's inside the album. We're okay.
Yeah.
We can take this wherever we want, Don.
There you go. It goes where we say it goes.
Look, you're drinking early in the morning, so what does it matter?
It's coffee. Oh, okay. And just so everybody knows, we record at like 8:30 in the morning, so we're fresh.
It's the only choice we have. We're old.
Yeah, old. We're up early. So there's two other albums, two pop albums that were big that year. The first Whitney Houston album called Whitney. And then Faith by George Michael was another popular album in 1987.
I don't know if you know this. I'm a huge George Michael fan.
Really?
All kidding aside. I always thought he was a fantastic artist.
Great
singer. Yeah, yeah. You got to have faith. You got to.
I guess you do. So the Appetite for Destruction peaked at number one on the U.S. Billboard charts, and it became the seventh best-selling album of all time in the United States, as well as the best-selling debut album ever.
Yep.
And as of today, it's sold over 30 million copies worldwide, making it one of the best-selling albums of all time.
It's amazing. Best-selling debut album. I saw that. I was like, wow, that's interesting, you know, for a band to just come and have that much impact. Very powerful.
Yeah. Yeah. And there are a few debut albums that are really strong, but generally they're not the strongest albums for.
Right. They're usually like an introduction to the band and you go from there, right? And you build on it. Yeah. I agree with you. Let's get that album out, get you guys out there. But they were ready to rock.
Right. So they had been playing frequently on the LA club scene, the Sunset Strip, that whole area in Los Angeles. In the mid 80s, so 85, 86, they were out there clubbing every night and playing shows. And they were going to release an EP back in 1985, but the original guitar player, Tracy Guns, decided to leave the band. And that's when Slash was brought in. So the EP project was scrapped. But funny enough, some of those songs that they were planning to record ended up on later Guns N' Roses albums, one on this album, one on the Use Your Illusion album.
Use Your Illusion, yeah.
Take a look at the cover art here. And so there was an original version. There's two versions of the cover for this album. The original version has this painting by Robert Williams, and the painting is called Appetite for Destruction. So that's where they got the idea, you know, for the name. And it depicted a robotic rapist about to be punished by a metal avenger.
Nice.
So it was pretty, it's cartoony, but it's kind of graphic. And after several music retailers refused to stock the album, the label compromised and then put the cover that we see now, the Celtic cross with the band members as skulls on the cross. So that's, you know, that was a case of they couldn't sell it with that original cover. So they went ahead and changed it.
Yeah. You know, the robotic rapist, you know, it's not easy to push.
Is that a line?
What a world.
I can't cross robotic rapist.
I'm sorry.
That's too far.
Please. But you think, well, the second album cover is really, as we use the word a lot, it's iconic. It's a great album cover.
Yeah.
I love everything about it.
It's very recognizable. You know, people are familiar with it in general, I think.
Oh, yeah.
And then so the album was released in like I said, in 1987 in July. And at the end of August, it debuted at number 182 on the Billboard album chart.
Yep.
But several months after its release, it had only sold 200,000 copies. So the record company, which was Geffen, was kind of walking away from the record. So, like, you know, these record companies, they go all in on the stuff that was hot. And if it's not, they don't put any resources to it generally. So the radio stations did not originally want to play the band. Well, the first single, Welcome to the Jungle. And originally MTV hadn't any desire to air any of its music videos. And again, this is mid 80s is prime MTV time. Woo. Bands were being broken by video all the time. Like new bands were coming out, that mid-80s techno, you know, new wave stuff was all through MTV, really. That's how that was all broken.
A little aha for you.
Aha, yeah, all that stuff.
Aha.
So the record company was lobbying MTV for months to play the video, like literally months. And they finally convinced MTV to play the video for Welcome to the Jungle just once a night for three consecutive nights.
Oh, okay.
And after they did that, Welcome to the Jungle became the most requested video on MTV. And that success then allowed them to pitch the record to radio stations while selling them the promo copies of Welcome to the Jungle, Paradise City, and Sweet Child of Mine. So again, they leveraged MTV to get airplay on the radio.
It's wild. And Welcome to the Jungle video, Jim Carrey was in that.
Oh, really? I didn't know that.
Oh yeah.
Was he in the first scene, like when Axl comes off the bus?
Yep. It was, he was playing like a nutty guy on it. So yeah, Jim, a young Jim Carrey, as they say.
There you go.
Is that, now listen, I wanted my MTV back then. You know that.
Yeah. Of course. All right. So let's dive in here. I mean, classic album that most people love. So we'll start off with the first track. This one is Welcome to the Jungle.
Nice.
So this is, to me, this is like the ultimate opener song, right? The music at the beginning is such a great buildup, You know, and they just tear into it right away. So you can tell what's going on here. You can tell that, you know, right away you get the vibe that this band is just dirty and rocking, right? It's got that, the sound has that feel to it, right? It's kind of nasty.
Yeah, well, you know, it's Axl's voice, and, you know, thank God for Slash. But if you listen to the music in the background behind Slash and Axl Rose, it's a pretty basic beat. You know what I mean? It's a great driving.
Yeah. Oh yeah, straight ahead. Right.
It's just straight ahead. Yeah, rock and roll.
Yeah, straight ahead.
The way we like it.
Yep. So the song is about Los Angeles, and it kind of exposes the dark side of the city that many people encounter when they go there to pursue fame. So they knew this side of the city well, because in 1985, they lived in a place on Sunset Boulevard in Los Angeles they called Hell House. Nice. And the house was often filled with drugs, alcohol, and groupies.
Oh, wow.
How's that hell? Isn't that heaven?
Well, depends on where you're at. Drugs, alcohol, and groupies. No beds, no, just drugs.
Right. No, yeah, well, yeah, right.
Bed bugs.
You're probably right. Beds. There probably weren't a lot of beds. It was probably a lot of kids like just crashing on the floor, right?
Listen, hey, like you said, you're talking about kids. And you know, it's funny, LA now LA's even worse now. They should rewrite this. Oh my God. Crazy.
So Axl wrote the lyrics when he was in Seattle. When he was in Seattle, you know, a much smaller city, it gave him a perspective on the size of Los Angeles and, you know, how big and sprawling it is.
Was he the lead singer in LA Guns, Axl Rose? Is that where it all started?
No, that was the band, I think, that Tracy Guns started after he left.
Oh, okay.
Tracy Guns was in is Guns N' Roses. He's the Guns in Guns N' Roses. Yeah, but then he left and made his band LA Guns.
And then Slash
came in. And then Slash came in and played guitar for Guns N' Roses.
Gotcha.
So Slash said he was at his house and he had the riff he was fooling around with. And Axl came over and then put the lyrics together and the band sort of arranged it. And he said that's how they worked. You know, the whole band, someone would come in with an idea and the whole band would give some input, you know, so they all kind of really kind of worked on the songs. So it's not, you know, even though a lot of people think it's Axl and Slash, everybody was contributing musically in this band.
It helps.
It helps
together.
Yeah, it helps you keep the band happy, right?
You hope. But, you know, certainly the big personas were Slash and Axl.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, by far. I mean, you know, you can't avoid that. You know, it's just the stage presence. The way they were on stage was amazing and great, too.
And Axl will punch you in the face.
Yeah, you know, and it, for people who are seeing Guns N' Roses today, it's not the same band that it was in the mid-80s. You know, it was mayhem. You know, they would go, the shows would stop because Axl got pissed off. They walked off stage in St. Louis once and it caused a riot. He got pissed off at somebody taking a picture and he said, the security sucks, I'm out of here, and just walks off stage in the middle of a show.
Nice. Yeah. As a sidebar. Yeah. I get it. Yeah. I saw them in Giant Stadium. That's when they actually did the recording for Paradise City.
Yeah. Yeah. Was that during the Metallica where they toured with Metallica? Cause I think I was at that show.
Here's a show for you. Let's just throw it out there. It probably fits nowhere in what we're talking about, but they opened up for Deep Purple and Aerosmith.
Oh, okay. Okay.
Yeah. Look at that, right? So it's like, wow, what interesting. And I learned the lesson that day, and so did Guns N' Roses. I'll throw it out to you. You couldn't hear Guns N' Roses, right? Deep Purple got a little louder. Aerosmith hit the stage. It was totally like Aerosmith's night. You know what I mean?
I could just picture Steven Tyler backstage with the master volume turning everything down.
Yeah. Oh, right? Absolutely. That's how it worked back then. You had to work your way up the pecking order. They didn't care who you were.
That's true. That's true. Oh, yeah. So Axl did say that he, one time when he was a kid, he spent a night in this Queens schoolyard, you know, before he was in the band. And this black guy had come up to him and it was late at night. And he goes, "You're in the jungle. You're going to die." And that's where he kind of got the, you know, that's where he got that line from the song, which is interesting.
I like it.
All right. So let's.
Same inflection.
Yeah.
You're going to die.
Right. Exactly.
Yeah.
So let's dive into track number two. This one is called It's So Easy.
Mm-hmm.
So this one was written at the time when the band was coming up on the rise. You know, they're playing shows. They've got some local popularity, but they had no money. So their bank accounts had yet to catch up with their success. And so what was so easy was getting girls. There were groupies everywhere ready to take care of the band's needs.
Ah, there you go.
So
works. I should have picked up the guitar.
Yeah. And so, of course, you know, today this is, it's looked at in different light and it's, you know, a little misogynistic and all those sort of things. But the other side of it is that at the time, you know, this stuff was going on and these guys were not fake at all. This is what they lived. They were living this, you know, crazy drugs, sex, drugs and rock and roll lifestyle.
Are you saying today we can't say chicks take rock and roll? Is that what you're saying?
I think we can still say that. I have to check my book on things you can say.
Yeah, chicks is out. Chicks is out, though.
Chicks is out. So, you know, they're not posers. That's kind of my point. And in the 80s, you had a lot of these bands who kind of tried to, you know, 80 in the 80s, you started with the hair bands and then the heavier metal like Metallica and the thrash and this kind of stuff started bubbling up. And so you got some of these hair bands that were trying to seem tougher and, you know, a little bit more rock and roll and more real, you know, when in the most cases, a lot of them were kind of fake, I think. But these guys were, this was how they were living.
Yeah, they were out of their minds.
Yeah,
they really were. They were deep into it, you know.
Yeah, yeah.
Especially the drug scene.
Yeah, it got really bad, and we're going to talk about that in a couple of songs. But this song was actually written, It's So Easy was written by Duff McKagan, who's the bass player. And it was released as the first single for Appetite for Destruction, but it just flopped. It didn't gain any traction at all. They followed it then later on with Welcome to the Jungle, then Sweet Child of Mine, and Sweet Child of Mine hit number one in the US.
You sure did.
All right, so let's jump ahead. We're going to go on to the next track here, which is Night Train. You like that, huh? He smokes a cigarette with style.
Well, listen, look at us.
With these guys, style. Yeah, these guys are the original, like they're the original swag, you know, they were strutting. I remember them going on TV in the mid 80s and some award show. And this was before they had, you know, the 5 second or 7 second delay.
Right.
And they were just hammered. There was Slash and Izzy, I think. And you could see they were just been pounding Jack Daniels. And they were just, every other word was fuck this, fuck that. It was hilarious. But this song is Night Train, if anybody doesn't know, is a very cheap wine that Guns N' Roses drank a lot of while recording Appetite for Destruction. It's also the drink of choice for bums and hobos.
Well, Don, welcome to my world.
The world of hobos?
Well, in the 80s, I used to do a lot of Night Train. And you know, really? My story, you know, my back. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
It's literally the thing about, I always explain to everybody about Night Train. It was like $1 a pint, $2 a quart, you know,
right. And it's cheap.
And, but it was literally drugs in a bottle. It affected you in a way you could never imagine.
Really?
For $2, you were blitzed. Not just drunk, like spaced just out.
Beyond your mind, hammered.
Because it's the cheapest crap you could ever put in a bottle. It's the bottom of the barrel, is what they used to say. So it literally, I used to say it was drugs in a bottle for $2. And that's why people would, we used to say, me and my buddy, we used to get on, it's time to get on the train. That's what we said before this song came out. It's time to get on the train. So we would drink Night Train and play Scrabble.
Oh my God.
Dude.
So you're really hardcore, huh?
True story.
Dude, that's like family night activities.
I love saying
Night
that.
Train and Scrabble.
We would wake up, say it's time to get on a train, and sit and play Scrabble. That was my life, boy.
Wow, you had some problems, buddy.
I don't anymore, thank God, but I can relate to the train.
Can you play Scrabble to this day?
Not as well.
Oh, too funny. Yeah. Oh my God.
True story. The train.
That's crazy. So again, it's, you know, this is about, this song is just about how they were reckless and crazy and poor, and that's the only alcohol they could afford.
Reckless, crazy, and poor. Thank you.
Yeah, so like before they got famous, after every show, they would get drunk and walk back home, you know, back home singing the lyrics of Night Train until it finally came together. So this is a song that came out of them being hammered, which is crazy.
It's crazy.
Too funny.
I'd love to talk to them about getting on the train. It would be a great talk.
Yeah, right? Could you imagine?
I could truly relate. I'd love to hear their stories.
I think you'd lose them when you broke out the Scrabble board, though.
Well, I'm talking about total irresponsibility. That was my day. How about that? Night Train and Scrabble. My parents were proud.
Yeah, I bet.
There's my boy.
There's my boy. Look at him. He just got an 8-letter word, 8-point word.
He used Q.
He used Q without the U. It's insane.
Unbelievable.
All right. Let's move on to the next track. This one is Out to Get Me. The other thing about this record, and you see it here in this song, is they like to curse in their songs. And in 1987, that was not a good thing. They didn't play this on the radio because of these things.
Explicit lyrics.
Yeah, exactly. This was the start of that, that, right?
I love that.
It told you which were the good albums to get.
And I'm the kind of guy, too.
When you're a kid.
You know, and just I don't even know if it's necessary, if it's just like, you know, why it should be in there. You know, you should just, you know, fuck this and fucking that. I don't know.
It's not your thing.
It's not. I find it not necessary just in the music. You know, for me, you know, listen, I like music. I like melody and I like great lyrics. And
yeah,
I think it's a shortcut to what do you call it? Like being outrageous. We're outrageous, you know?
And yeah. I mean, it's that. A bit of, you know, it's, I think it's a bit, it's, they're young and the audience is young and it's like, you know, they're angry and angsty and I think it's just a reinforcement of that, you know?
I get it.
So this song railed against the unwarranted harassment from authorities that the Guns N' Roses members often faced. At some point somewhere, someone was out to get the whole band, but mainly Axl Rose. So he had a lot of this paranoia. It wasn't unfounded, but there were a few problems for those who had their sights set on the singer. He couldn't be caught. He was innocent and couldn't be broken. So, you know, that's the song is. So you know, no matter what you try, you're not going to be able to get to me.
Mm. Except for the demons.
Yeah, right. Yeah. Well, the demons, that's a whole nother story. Yeah. So Duff McKagan again said that the cops busted down their door one night looking for Axl. They wanted him to answer for what turned out to be a bogus rape charge. So there was all sorts of crazy shit going on with these guys at this time.
Oh, yeah. Oh, the pure insanity.
Yeah, and you know, it just shows up in every song.
And you know what we were just saying, I don't think Duff gets enough credit for actually being, he was kind of semi-stable in the band.
Yeah, he probably was the most stable one. Steven Adler, the drummer, was off his rocker.
Off his rocker.
Slash was he had a huge issue. Izzy, they all were using heroin and drinking like Jack Daniels like it was water. I don't know how much Axl did in terms of drugs. I'm sure he drank a lot, but you know, he was a diva at the time. He used to not show up. At one time at Madison Square Garden, the show was supposed to start like, you know, 7:30, whatever. The opening act came on. He refused to go on because it was Friday the 13th. He wouldn't go on until midnight at Madison Square Garden.
Yeah, there's the demons we're talking about. Like he didn't know it was scheduled.
No, he knew, but yeah. he sat in the limousine. It's funny. I got that story from, I was in a poker game and I was playing poker with a guy who did electric at Madison Square Garden. And he's the one who told me that story. He said he was sitting in the limo until midnight and then they went on. You know, these days,
through the years, we were talking about, I saw interviews with Steve Adler, you know, and he was a sweetheart of a guy who just got beat up. You felt so bad for him, man.
Yeah, he was on one of those rehab shows in the 90s, I think.
Oh, my God.
You know, one of those reality shows.
Dr. Drew. Yeah,
which I always thought those shows were so awful. How do you put that on TV for somebody trying to recover?
Wow.
And it was sad to watch because he just kept relapsing and stuff. But
well, they pay him each show. He'd come back each show. He'd go buy dope with the money they paid him for the show.
Yeah, probably. Right, exactly.
Yeah, listen, I get it. I fully understand. But I forgot about those Dr. Drew shows. Horrible.
Yeah, that was awful.
Yeah.
All right. So let's move on. The next song, hey, it's a song about drugs. Mr. Brownstone.
Great song.
So, heroin, Mr. Brownstone is heroin, if anybody hasn't figured that out yet. It's not a common slang term for heroin, or wasn't, but it is brown. And it was likely that that's where the dealer got his. So they were saying Mr. Brownstone was the heroin dealer, I guess.
Yeah, I would think people have told me along the way that, it's the building where you would go cop.
Oh, that probably makes a lot more sense. Yeah.
Yeah. Mr. Brownstone. Yeah.
Right.
You know, and, so the whole idea of it's usually an apartment building, something to that effect where you go to cop. It's not. So it's not that I know, but I'm just throwing it out there for something I read.
Something you read. So they, you know, he talks about, now I get up around whenever I used to get up on time, and kind of meaning that he doesn't care anymore because he's just so obsessed with heroin and that's his life.
This song is a great song. I've always loved this song. It's my favorite Guns N' Roses song. The reason being is it's from the heart. This one, they're like,
right
out, like, oh my God, what are we going to do? I used to do a little, but a little wasn't working. So I had to do more and more. Right. Yeah, that's the sacrifice. You know, you give yourself up to that shit and you can't get off it for sure.
Yeah. Yeah. So, and that's why it's a like problem for so many. Yeah. All right. So let's dive into
a scourge.
It definitely is. So let's dive into something a little bit happier. This one is Paradise City. So this song, like Welcome to the Jungle, is inspired by Los Angeles, where the band was living at the time. And the verses deal with the rough life on the streets, but the chorus is based on Axl Rose's memories of the Midwest with the images of green grass, innocence, and possibility.
Ah, there you go. You know, I have a confession to make as I listen to this album, and there's something about Guns N' Roses that doesn't resonate with me, but then there's some songs that you just say, my God, that's good. You know, and this is one of them. It's a great tune. Great tune.
And you can tell, you know, the great songs from the past, you hear them like these days with cover bands, you know, in bars and stuff like that. And so I was at a bar, you know, a month or two ago, and the band was playing, you know, Paradise City and everything, and just rocking out to it. Great song.
I have to tell you, I'll give you my cover band story. I'm out with Cheryl. We stop in as a cover band playing. The girl starts singing Dream On. I say, grab your coat. I swear to God, you can ask my wife. I said, that's sacrilege.
No.
No one should be singing Dream On in a bar unless it's Steven Tyler.
Yeah, but they're doing it, Tom.
Oh, Don, and that's why I'm staying away, but that's okay.
So that's hilarious. Grab your coat. Slash wanted the chorus to be, take me down to the Paradise City where the girls are fat and they got big titties.
Right.
He hated the grass is green line, but the band overruled him to make the song more radio friendly.
Yeah, fat with big titties. Now what? What's so bad? Is that explicit literally?
I was back then. It's not now, I guess. I don't know.
Oh, God. You could use titties today. You just can't use the word fat. That's the difference.
So this is the only track on the album that has a prominent synthesizer.
Synthesizer, yes.
Yeah, and that was Axl's idea, and he plays the synth on this.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
I didn't know who it was. I thought maybe they brought somebody into the studio.
No, he plays keyboard. So, okay. You know, he played on November Rain. He plays that piano part and everything. So,
yeah.
You know, so that was Axl's idea. And this is the first song that the original lineup of Slash, Steven Adler, Duff, Axel, and Izzy all wrote together. So all five members are credited as writers. And according to Duff, they started working on it during one of their first rehearsals and just started with some lyrics that that he brought in that he had in a notebook, that Duff's had in a notebook. So
yeah, they did a video for this that was pretty much a live performance piece together. It was the one from Giant Stadium.
Yeah.
Yeah. It was a great video.
Yeah, yeah. So great song, legendary song.
Really is.
And still played
to warm up.
Still, yeah, there you go. Still played by cover bands around the world.
Grab my coat.
Grab your coat, Cheryl. We're out of here. The next one is a track called My Michelle. So this one was written about Michelle Young. It's actually a girl who was a friend of the band at the time. And when she was traveling to a gig with the band, Elton John's Your Song came on the radio, and she remarked how she always wanted a song written about her. She said she was grateful that they did not sugarcoat her life in the song, because she was one of these groupies and was all in with these guys in terms of the, you know, the sex, drugs, and rock and roll thing.
Yeah. You always want a song written about you that starts off with porn, heroin, and death. Yeah,
it's a winning combination.
Thank you so much, Elton John. It was Elton John.
From Elton John to to porno and a dead mom.
This is your song. Heroin and death.
So like we said before, early on the band had a support network of women who kept them fed and sheltered and you know, took care of other things.
Did you come up with that phrase, support network?
No, that's a direct quote from the groupies.
That's
what they call themselves.
Yeah, there you go. I need me a support network, Dot. If you know,
but it was you know, it was these girls were their friends who had the similar sensibilities and unhealthy habits.
Friends with benefits and many other things.
Yeah, exactly.
Yes.
So she was hoping for something sweet and asked for a song about her, but Axel instead delivered this lyric based on her hard scrabble life.
Wow.
And she actually said at the time, I didn't care because I was so fucked up. But exactly. What it says is all true. My dad does distribute porno films and my mom did die.
Mm.
So it's a true story.
Yeah. So the lyrics just came naturally.
Yeah. It just flowed, right? It's just telling the story.
Yeah, as we're talking about Guns N' Roses here, you know, as I listen to the songs, the one thing you could always say about a really good band or a great band mm-hmm. is they have their sound. If it comes on, you know it's them. There's right. no way around it. No, so I was just thinking about this whole album. It's their sound, which you gotta give them credit for.
Yeah, yeah, without a doubt.
You know, Slash creates a lot of it, and I don't know, through the years he's progressed, and you know, you see a different side of Slash. But he's a tremendous guitar player to start with.
Oh, yeah.
Not just the sound he gets out of his guitar on this album, but he's a great blues player. I've seen him play with John Mayer. I've seen him play with B.B. King. The guy can play.
Yeah, I actually saw him. I saw Velvet Revolver at Starland Ballroom, which is a club here in New Jersey. So it's maybe 2,000 people.
Tops, wow, that must have been great, though, man.
Wow. But it was insane. So we were right up on the stage and like literally feet in front of Slash. And the guy is rock and roll. He's just like, you might think it's a put on. It's not. It's just him. That's who he is, you know.
So he is.
But just amazing. And that band was three of them were Guns N' Roses people. And then Scott Weiland on vocals. So it was very close to Guns, but.
Yeah, I would love to see that. The Starland's a great place. For those who don't know, in New Jersey, we've had some great times at the Starland Ballroom.
Yes.
One time I went to the Starland and Leslie West was playing.
Oh, nice.
And, dude, it was nice right up until the point he made them put his amp up to like 22. He was melting. He was melting 22. People. Oh, dude, it was like so crazy. It was
that's insane.
Oh, dude.
Jeez.
Well, Leslie West lost it a little while ago, but that's all good. I digress.
Yeah.
Back to Guns N' Roses.
All right. So let's move on. We'll go on to track number 8. This one is Think About You. So this track was actually written by Izzy Stradlin, which, you know, a lot of people, I think, first of all, I don't know how many people actually know Izzy.
Right.
I don't think people think of him as a songwriter in the band. I think everybody thinks that Slash and Axl are the guys who create all the music, but it's not true.
They were the band.
It was a band effort.
Yeah, oh, sure. Yeah, they were a band. It's just that the popularity exploded with, you know, Slash had his look, Axl right. had his attitude.
The personalities are what catch people's eye.
Yep, yep. Izzy, you wouldn't even know he was on stage. Serious. He was
don't
just
tell Izzy that.
He was just, no, he was a great part of the band, but he was always in the background.
Right. Well, you think about it, you've got two personalities who are like on a scale of 1 to 10 in terms of vibrance and kind of look at me. Yep. They're like 50, you know, so you got Slash and Axl both who are just have these personalities that people are just drawn to.
And I hate to put it, but, you know, I guess you could say rhythm guitar, backup guitar. He was the backup guitarist. I mean, rhythm guitar. You know,
Yeah. I mean, they're both really, you know, they're kind of like the Stones in terms of they're both playing different parts, you know.
Right.
A lot gotcha. Of bands, you have the two guitars are playing the same thing. And then there's some bands where, you know, one guy's doing one riff, another guy's doing another riff, and then it comes together and sounds really great together.
Perfect.
So this song is about falling in love, and it was written by Izzy before he joined Guns N' Roses. And Tracy Guns, who was quoted as saying, it's about Monique Lewis, who everybody in the band dated at one time. So this is one of these girls who was dating each of the guys in different times. And dated. And Axl actually has a tattoo of her on his arm.
Oh, boy.
So that's Izzy's girlfriend ended up on Axl's arm.
He must have been on the train that night.
The train.
Get on the train, Don.
He must have been playing Scrabble.
There you go. Double words going, my friend.
There you go. All right, let's move on to track number 9. This is probably the most well-known Guns N' Roses song of all time, and it's Sweet Child of Mine. So this one was, the lyrics were written by Axel. It was a poem that he had written for his, about his girlfriend, Erin Everly, who was the daughter of Don Everly from the Everly Brothers. Yeah.
There you go.
So after dating for 4 years, they got married with a quickie wedding in Las Vegas in 1990. But 9 months later, the marriage was annulled with Everly claiming abuse. So.
Claiming.
Yeah. We don't know. I don't know.
You got to throw those words in. That's all good.
I don't find it hard to believe that he smacked somebody around.
We'll edit that out. Yes.
When Sweet Child of Mine was released as the third single in June of 1988, it made a steady climb to the top, bringing the album with it, and the song hit number one in September of 1988. So in the wake of Sweet Child, they re-released Welcome to the Jungle, and then it became a hit song.
It was a major hit. Let me ask you, Don, I got a question for you, buddy. Answer it if you can. You ever have one of those songs that you'll never listen to again?
Not really. I know you have a bunch of those, but I really don't get, I don't listen to it as often, but I get it. Yeah. And that's what people don't realize is how played out songs used to get because you didn't have as many places to listen, you know?
Yeah. This was on constant, man.
If you were in a big city, you had maybe two rock stations.
Yeah.
You know, if you weren't in a big city, you had one rock station and you would hear Sweet Child of Mine every hour.
Yeah. Every on the hour.
Yeah.
Gotcha. So
this is another one where the guitar player Slash was just fooling around, had this riff.
Yeah.
He thought it was silly and wanted nothing to do with it, but Axel loved it and had him keep playing it. And then Izzy came in and added some chords on top of it. So again, here you got that riff, and then Izzy's like, bang, bang, you know, behind it.
Yeah.
And then the song came together as, you know, they're kind of jamming on this stuff. And Slash still considers it the worst Guns N' Roses song, but he's got to play it every night because they're out touring now. So
he said it was like pulling teeth putting this song together.
Yeah, I imagine. Yeah, it's a long song too.
You know what, I saw a quote when he talks about this. He said that we built up this bad boy persona and then we wrote this song that was like a ballad. And he found conflict in it, you know. which is kind of interesting.
Yeah, you know, I mean, about that, this whole album is so charging forward. It's so heavy and fast, and you know, mm-hmm. I mean, it's not like early Metallica, which is just like bonkers fast and pushing right. forward, but it's still, you know, you've got 12 songs on the album and 11 of them are like, da-da-da, you know, so I think you need a break. You need a ballad in there.
And you would die to write a song like that. Let's not kid ourselves. It's a tremendous song.
And it's the most popular song they have. So, you know.
And I find it interesting, you know, Joe Walsh, another great guitar player, often talked about he'd be sitting jamming. And we covered it.
Yeah.
And Glenn Frey walked in and said, "My God, what are you playing?" And he said, "I'm just loosening up before I go on stage." And I believe it was Life in the Fast Lane.
Yeah, we've had that story over and over and over again. You know, we had it with Eddie Van Halen and a couple of other guitar players. Yeah,
it becomes a song.
It's amazing.
That stuff I love when you just piece that.
Yeah, and it shows you that the artists sometimes can't tell which songs are going to be, you know, most times I think they can't tell which songs are going to be popular, you know.
Oh, my God, no, I couldn't imagine. Imagine having to write a hit. Who wants to think about that? You want to write a song?
That's a lot of pressure, right?
A lot of pressure. Got to write a hit. Yeah, that's a lot of pressure.
All right, let's get back into the fast songs. This one is You're Crazy. So this song changed a lot when it was originally written. It was a slow acoustic song that they wrote while they were sitting around in the living room one night.
Oh, you're crazy.
You're fucking crazy.
Look at that, Don. We got some mad skills, man.
Yeah, we're good.
Oh, yes. yeah, we're good.
So they're sitting around jamming it and they go, okay, hey, we got something here. Let's go down to the studio that they're working out of. And then they upped the tempo to about 20 times what it was before, made it a lot faster, turned everything up to 12. And all of a sudden they had like they were going at this breakneck speed on the song, and they actually Axl enjoyed making the adjustment and they were real happy with the results. And you know, it's again, it's super fast.
Just the driving beat, you know. Yeah. I mean, what it is they're taking these basic driving beats and turning them into Guns N' Roses.
Yeah, exactly.
Axl's voice / his guitar.
Right.
You know, if it was done by somebody else, you wouldn't even recognize the song.
No, of course not. Yeah.
And I have to tell you know, Axl's voice, one of a kind.
Yeah. Yeah. I like it and hate it, you know, both at the same time. But, I think it fits well with what they're doing.
It was what it was. He actually has two voices. You notice he has a deeper voice he uses sometimes and that high shrieking or shrill sound. And it's interesting that sometimes they overdub one on top of the other.
Yeah. You get a lot of Axl.
A lot of Axl. All Axl all the time.
Nice. That's what we like.
There's your sound bite. All Axel, all the time.
All right. Let's go to track number 11. This one is Anything Goes.
Anything.
This one to me is kind of a throwaway on the album. And to me, it kind of sounds like Aerosmith, right?
Dude, I didn't bring it up a few songs back, but you big influence on their whole approach to the music flow and is Aerosmith. No doubt.
Yeah, without a doubt. You can hear it in a lot of songs. I think here you really, really hear it. It sounds like a Joe Perry riff almost.
Right.
Good.
No, I'm trying to think because the other guitarist in Aerosmith,
Brad Whitford.
If you ever watch the two of them play off there, you know, Brad Whitford's in the back and Joe Perry's up front, yes, but it's Whitford killing it the whole night, killing it.
But again, another band where you have two guitar players who are like the Stones, you know, it's two separate riffs, you know, but it all comes together great.
I've watched them jamming with the mics on, the two of them. Oh my God, man. Fred Whitford,
right?
Tremendous guitar player. Tremendous. Oh my God. Yeah. Yeah. So they do have a sound of Aerosmith. I agree with you.
Yeah. Yeah. Definitely. Definitely a big influence. This song was actually written in 1984. So it's an old song. And it's rarely been performed live. So maybe the band feels about it the way I do, that it's kind of a tosser and a filler on this album. Yes. But
we need another song.
Yeah. So anyway, all right, let's move on to the album closer. And this one is Rocket Queen. So this song, it was actually written about Barbie von Grief.
Oh,
she hung out with the. What's that?
Is that Barbie's last name?
I guess so. Yeah, I don't know if that's real or fake or what. She hung out with the band in their early years, along with her roommate Pamela Manning, and Slash called her a queen of the underground scene.
Ah, there you go.
Not a lot is known about her, but she's not the girl moaning in the song. So later on in the song, we can't play the whole song here, but there is a woman with sexual moans that's in the background of the song.
Is that how it's written out? Sexual moans?
Moaning and other sex sounds that appear in the middle of the song were recorded while Axl Rose was having sex with a woman in the recording studio.
Oh, fantastic. Terrific.
And she was drummer Steven Adler's girlfriend.
So in other sounds, do you hear, is it like a bedboard hitting a wall? What's the other sound? What could it possibly be?
It's just kind of like,
Hey, reach out to us and tell us how you feel about that question.
So the woman's name was Adriana Smith, and she did the deed for the band one night when she was mad at Adler.
Take one for the team.
Yeah, for that song, there was also something I tried to work out with various people, a recorded sex act, Axel said. It was somewhat spontaneous, but premeditated, something I wanted to put on the record. It was a sexual song, and it was a wild night in the studio.
Yeah, there you go. I'm going to start writing music.
First, you have to get a drummer with a hot girlfriend.
This is true. This is true. I'm with you. You know, it's fascinating. I'm just listening to the whole album, you know, and maybe that's what it is, you know, because as Guns N' Roses came along, I went through so much rock and roll in my life. Let's face it, you know, the 70s, early 80s, right? You know,
sure.
Rock and roll, for me, growing up hearing stuff from the 60s, the 70s, the Beatles. Yeah, I hear a lot of the same riffs. They're just in Guns N' Roses sound.
Right.
Guitar riffs, you know what I mean? It's like boom, ba, boom, ba, boom, boom.
Oh, yeah.
It's all been played before.
And like you said, there's a heavy Aerosmith influence with these guys. You know, yeah. You hear it very frequently.
But then again, as Keith Richards once said, all you need is four chords.
Yeah, right? It's rock and roll, baby.
He truly believed in that. He could write anything with four chords.
Yeah. And he does.
He's the best. He's the best, man. And he's still alive.
Yeah.
Wow.
Amazing. So that's Appetite for Destruction by Guns N' Roses.
Wow. You know what? Again, one of those albums that everybody had. You know what I was thinking? When did CDs come into play? Was it around this time then?
Yeah, it was like 84, 85. Okay. They started, really, I guess.
Yeah, so I was wondering, actually, if I had the album or I had the CD. I was trying to figure
out. Probably had the CD. This is really, 87 right? Was really kind of now where people were moving away from vinyl.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking about. I couldn't, I know I had it. I couldn't put it into where it was.
Yeah.
Maybe even cassette. Who knows?
There you go. Could have been.
All right. That was great. Good job, man.
Yeah. Thanks for listening, everybody. Thanks for watching. We're on YouTube. We're on every podcast platform out there. So listen to us, share us, get your friends and family to listen, click the buttons, do the things. That would be awesome.
Push, hit, whatever you got to do.
Yeah. We'll be back soon with another great record.
I can't wait.
All right. Have a good day.
See you, Don.
Bye.